Very good evening to all of you. So you're most welcome to the first and the only evening lecture, that's a public lecture, of the second week of this program. So this is an interesting topic. I have heard Professor Darshan Shankar once very recently, and without any hesitation, I must say that he has the full authority on this topic. Even an individuals, to just give the context of the today's lecture, let me put it in this way. As individuals, we all must have experienced some kind of ailments at some point of our life. When we are affected by any disease, then we would look up to a doctor for treatment. Now, if I have a particular problem or particular disease or particular ailments, so which doctor I should go to? Should I go to an allopathic doctor or a homeopathic doctor or an ayurvedic doctor? We generally leave it to the patients. I think personally, it is too much a thing to leave it to the patients, because in the matters of health, I think people will tend to or aspire to take the minimum risk. So why not a homeopathic doctor, an ayurvedic doctor and an allopathic doctor sit together and decide for what ailments, which kind of treatments needs to be provided. There comes the topic of integrative health care. And as I said, we have Padma Shri Darshan Shankar with us today's evening to speak out his mind on this topic. So to give a brief introduction of our today's speaker, Padma Shri Darshan Shankar is the Managing Trustee of Foundation for Revitalization of Local Health Traditions, that is FRLHT, Bangalore. He is a former advisor to the Planning Commission for the Health Sector. He is currently the Vice Chancellor of Transdisciplinary University. You must have been in NIAS for more than a week now. You must have heard many times multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary research work. So we think there is some kind of commonality between NIAS and TDU in terms of the disciplinary biases or unbiases rather we have, or the disciplinary frontiers we transcend. Professor Darshan Shankar has extensively worked in the areas of decentralization, revitalization of community health practices based on traditional knowledge, experimental learning programs, and rural development initiatives across India. He was a consultant to the Office of the Advisor to the Prime Minister for inputs on National Technology Mission on Health. Professor Darshan Shankar has several publications to his credit. He has been conferred with Commonwealth Youth Service Award way back in 1976, even before I was born, for designing and implementing the best educational project in the Commonwealth for linking university education to community needs. In 1998, he was awarded Norman Borlaug Award for contributions to promoting conservation of wildlife population of medicinal plants. In 2002, he received the Equator Initiative Prize by the United Nations, and in 2003, the Columbia University's Center of Complementary and Alternative Medicine International Award went to Professor Shankar and FRLHT, that's the foundation he is associated with, in recognition to the foundation's outstanding contribution to revitalization of traditional system of healthcare in India. The Government of India, for all his contribution, has conferred him with the Padma Shri in 2011. Over to Professor Darshan Shankar, who is going to deliver the public lecture this evening on integrative healthcare, emerging paradigm in 21st century. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I feel honored to be here in NIAS. I have always been right from the start when Nia started, a great admirer of the vision behind this National Institute for Advanced Studies. And I think we are all fortunate to be here today for the program that one of the many programs that several programs that NIAS organizes to broaden the minds and perspectives of people with its multidisciplinary perspective. In 45 minutes or so that I will speak to you, I will in this limited time be able to share perspectives, some broad facts, a little bit of analysis, some policy framework, but I won't be able to get into details for two reasons. A, there won't be enough time, and this is a really large subject, and B, because I may not be competent to really address all the details involved in this particular talk. So the submission is that the emerging paradigm in the 21st century for healthcare, the emerging global paradigm, is going to be integrative healthcare. Now, this is not an opinion, it is not a prediction, and so let me tell you the basis of this. A very brief introduction to the university I represent. This is grown out of FRLHT, which Hippu has just introduced 23 years ago. It was founded by Mr. Sam Pitroda and myself. And it's only recently, in 2013, that it was legislated by the government of Karnataka into a state private university. Our focus in this, one of our central focus on this, is integrative healthcare. So let me show you the some broad facts about the ground reality in global healthcare. You have, of course, on one side a resurgence of infectious diseases. Even a situation like malaria, we are not, there is resurgence, and you know, all the research that has been going on malaria has shown that single molecules for single target don't work, because every 5 years you have to change your drug. Resistance develops, so even for infectious diseases, we are not finding that we have limited success globally in the management of non-communicable diseases. I would say myopic science and technology applications have resulted in polluted food, air, water, soils. We are all aware of this reality. There is today rise globally, it's just a beginning of something that is called One Health. There is a movement for One Health, saying that, you know, you can't deal with health only in the health sector. You'll have to look at agriculture, you'll have to look at environment, so you'll have to look at all the determinants of health, and it's not just within that health sector. So there's this One Health movement, which is an intersectoral kind of a movement that is arising. Even animal health, you know, because dairy and animal foods are also got huge amount of antibiotics, which are above, you know, limits for human consumption. On the other side, there are, you know, very promising, very exciting developments taking place in biology, in stem cell, in gene therapy, the understanding of the relationship between the microbiome and health, that you have, you know, many more micro organisms living in the body than 10 times more than the number of cells, and that they have a big role to play. And so there's a whole development happening about the relationship of the microbiome and health. You have robotic surgery, you have things in cancer like the cyber knife. Of course, you're having new framework for pharmacology through metabolomics, proteomics, transcriptomics. You have customized medicine on the anvil in modern medicine, the field of pharmacogenomics. You have a much wider framework for pharmacology, which is called network pharmacology. So all these are very exciting developments that are also happening side by side in the global healthcare scenario. You are seeing on the ground globally, and the WHO has brought out some document on this called the Global Atlas, that 40 to 70% of the global population exercise pluralistic choices, you know, something what Hippu was saying in Indian context, but it's globally that no one goes to any single system of medicine for all their problems. Depending on the nature of the problem, there would be, so this is the data on the ground, that health-seeking behavior is showing that as high as 70% in some countries, but 40 to 70% are actually exercising pluralistic choices. They're not going to any one single system of medicine. This is ground reality. There are modules that are have been introduced already in medical schools in the United States, in UK, in Australia, in several countries, not enough in our own country. There are modules that have been developed in mainstream medical education on that broad area called complementary medicine, you know, which is the one dimension of integrative health care, that you have other systems complementarily working complementary. You have substantial government investments in this integrative healthcare or complementary medicine research. In the United States, the National Institutes of Health almost 20-25 years ago started an office for complementary medicine, and annually their budgets are increasing, and the budget for this complementary medicine office, say in the National Institutes of Health, is perhaps larger than India's national budget, much larger than India's national budget on so-called Ayush systems. But you have other countries, particularly in Scandinavia, you have national institutes invested by the government on complementary medicine in Norway, in Sweden. You have lots of similar things happening in other. So governments are putting investments into research on complementary medicine, and the intention of the research is to establish safety, quality, efficacy. So this sort of investments are happening on a substantial scale from governments. There are a whole lot of regulations that have come up for complementary medicine, and they are there governing complementary medicine in the European Union, in the US, and Scandinavia, in Australia, Japan, everywhere. And now you have the growth of, which is also part of this integrative approach, you have the growth of what is called the wellness industry. It's at its inception, nevertheless it's quite large. I mean, it's already larger than the pharmaceutical industry, the wellness industry. And wellness is not a mainstream concept of biomedicine. It's an integrative sort of a concept. So all these are signs on the ground which are telling you what is the global healthcare scenario. In India, In India, the healthcare scenario is naturally somewhat similar. We have unmet basic needs. We don't have safe drinking water for our millions of rural and urban poor, Nutrition is an issue. Hygiene is an issue. We haven't been able to solve the problem of iron deficiency anemia. It's a very, very large problem. Mother and child care, we have, you know, unacceptable data in terms of infant mortality, maternal mortality, infectious diseases on the rise, NCDs on the rise, HIV, and so on and so forth. And the promise that we have given our people in all our plans, you know, of universal health care is really a distant dream, because as of 2016, 70% of the population is actually spending from out of pocket even for primary health care. So this is the ground reality in India. Now, this is the design of our public health system, which you are seeing in those two triangles. And it's an interesting design. In another sense, it's a flawed design. It's an interesting design because the larger triangle is primary, secondary, tertiary care. Primary at the bottom, in the middle, secondary, at the top, tertiary. That's the size of these three. And it is driven by, it's institutionally driven, and it's based on biomedicine or allopathy. Of course, four times larger than the public sector, which uses about 0.9% of the GDP, which compared to developed countries is small. Developed countries' public expenditure is of the order of 4% of GDP. And so there's always been a demand that India should also increase from 0.9 to maybe 1.5%, 2%, and take it up, etc. But thus far it is around 0.9% going into the public three-tiered system. Primary, secondary, tertiary, but four times larger is the private sector. So that is also functioning at primary, secondary, tertiary. And that's four times larger than the government sector, which is telling you that the government sector is not sufficiently efficient or effective, which is why the private sector has grown at all the three levels. So you, on one hand, you have this biomedicine program institutionally driven by government and private sector. On the other hand, you have a very small triangle there, which is essentially only primary and secondary. There is no tertiary in that one, which is based on seven legal systems of medicine that we have in India. Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, Swarigpa, that's the Tibetan, homeopathy, yoga, and so on and so forth, naturopathy. So you have this running parallelly, supported by the state, but you know they get about 97% of the national health budget goes into the biomedicine institutionally driven system. Less than 3% goes to all the other systems, Ayurveda, Yunani, Yoga, Siddha, all put together, homeopathy, everything get 3%. So it's a subcritical funding, but runs parallelly. There's no convergence between these two systems, knowledge systems. So although it's an interesting design of public health system, you won't see this picture in any other country, except perhaps in some way in China. That you have lots of systems of medicine working side by side, but with no convergence. So that's the flaw in the design, that they work parallelly, but no convergence at all. So the goals in the smaller triangle do not in any way match with the health goals in the larger triangle. That's the way it is functioning. Now, given the reality of unmet needs, of course, there are innovations that are going on in our society, and we must take note of them. It's not that nothing is happening. We know there are unmet needs, etc. And there are innovations also going on. And there are two broad categories of innovations that are ongoing in the health sector. In the first category are innovations of two types. One, to make the current system, which is, as I mentioned to you, that 70% of population is spending from out of pocket. So it's trying to make the current system a little bit more effective. So in this innovation, we are talking of generic drugs. So they are cheaper but effective, cost-effective drugs. Decentralization. There are various experiments going on insurance, providing insurance to the poor. To the rest, there are private insurance companies, but to the poor. Public health, strengthening public health dimension is another major sort of movement that is going on in the country. You have the Public Health Foundation of India, which is at work trying to create human resources for public health. Training of people, paramedics, medics, in various ways to sensitize them. So all these sorts of innovations are going on to try and improve the operations of the public health system. And then, of course, there are innovations happening in medical devices, and what is happening globally is happening here. Stem cell, gene therapy, robotics, artificial intelligence, various information technology applications, and so on and so forth. So all these are one, I'm putting them all under one broad category of innovations, which are trying to fix the problems in the biomedical driven public health system. There's a second category of innovations which are also ongoing in India, which is to engage our Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, Swarikpa, etc., all these systems and Western biomedicine in a complementary relationship. There are innovations going on here. The what was called the National Rural Health Mission. This is the biggest sort of initiative to try and deliver universal health coverage. It was launched by the UPA government in 2005, so now we are 10 years, a little more than 10 years, operating the National Rural Health Mission, which recently has been renamed as the National Health Mission, saying not only rural but also urban. And in this NHM, as it is now called, the innovation that is there in the design, in operations is a different story. But in the design, if you look at the preamble of the National Health Mission or the National Rural Health Mission, they say that the only way we will achieve this mission is if we involve all our healthcare knowledge systems, not only biomedicine, but Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, etc. So they have stated that in the design of the mission. But on the ground, while they have come out with a policy which is called co-location, co-posting. This is the policy of the National Rural Health Mission, where they say we will co-locate and co-post all the smaller triangle institutions of Ayush. So they are not geographically disjoint, but geographically they are in one place, co-location and co-posting. We'll post multiple doctors, of all systems in that same establishment. That's the policy. And every year you see their data saying so many institutions co-located, so many doctors co-posted. So they have done that, but thus far, so it's an innovation, but thus far it is only a mechanical co-location, co-posting. There are lots of nitty-gritties that have to be worked out to make it function in an integrative manner. Those have not been worked out. And as of now, it need not be so tomorrow. As of now, it looks like, it's cheaper to put a so-called Ayurveda, Ayush doctor inside a primary healthcare center at primary or secondary level. You pay him less than what you pay the other person. The other person is not willing to go to lots of areas. And so it's economics that is at work to deliver healthcare. So it's not integration on the ground. But the policy is towards integration, and when you read that document on NRHM or NHM, it's a very progressive preamble saying we have to employ all our knowledge systems to deliver. Another innovation happening on the ground is something that was initiated by a great visionary allopathic surgeon named Dr. M.S. Valyathan. And he has initiated this program, which is anchored in the Department of Science and Technology, not in the Ministry of Health. And that program is called Ayurveda Biology. It's a new coinage, a new research framework called Ayurveda Biology. It's already been working now for 7-8 years. Not a great deal of investment, maybe around, by now they would have spent around 50-60 crores over 7-8 years, not a great deal of money. But it is showing new directions, and I will give you an example of what directions it is showing about the potential of integrative medicine or integrative healthcare. So let me give you examples of what this innovation regarding Ayurveda biology is doing. Just some quick examples. So, and some of them are very interesting examples. This is example, I'm just giving you examples. There are lots of things happening, I'm giving you examples. So one is regarding the value of a traditional practice, which all of you are familiar with here, I'm sure in this room, that we used to store drinking water in copper vessels. Now, you need not store it in the copper vessel. You can have that kind of a simple device, a rod which you can put into plastic or aluminium or whatever, and this turns out to be the cheapest method that is available really for microbial purification of drinking water. It is going to cost, that sort of a device will cost something like 500 rupees or 600 rupees one time expenditure for the whole life, and within 8 hours this device is capable of destroying E. coli, Salmonella, Vibrio cholera, you know, rotavirus, Giardia, and everything. And there have been enough experiments done and papers written and published in peer-reviewed journals to show that this is perhaps the world's cheapest method for microbial purification of drinking water, and you can straight away accept that. I mean, where are you going to get a cheaper solution? 500 rupee one-time expenditure for the whole life. You can't find a cheaper solution than this. So this is an example of Ayurveda biology. Because, you know, to take this across, you had to do the science and show that, and only a part of the science has been done. This is science showing you that it destroys all the microbes. There's lots more science to be done on exact mode of action. We know that about 150, 200 parts per billion of ions leach out into the water. They get into the membranes of the organisms and kill them. But there's much more work to be done in terms of, but it works. This is another path-breaking work that has been done in Ayurveda biology, showing the potential of integrative health care. This is a field called Ayurgenomics. Those of you who are from CSIR should look up some of your institutions. By now, CSIR has put considerable amount of money. It was supposed to put 100 crore into this program of Ayurgenomics. In Samir Brahmachari's time, I don't know whether they have kept to that promise of 100 crore or whether that has got reduced to a smaller amount. I think it has got reduced to a smaller amount, but that was the promise. But it's going on. And this is a field which is very path-breaking because it has reduced the globally the time in this emerging area of pharmacogenomics by at least a decade. Because it has shown the genetic basis, how to do genotyping in a random population based on using the Ayurvedic phenotypes, and you find underlying these phenotypes you have locate the genotypes, and you know you can. So it has solved a big problem. Then there is this field of metallopharmaceuticals. This is something again that Dr. Valliathan has pushed. There is a interesting paper from people in the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, published in a very good journal, which has shown that a preparation called Rasa Sindura, this is an example, this is a mercury thing which is otherwise toxic. BARC has published a paper from its radiation physics division to show that this product, which is a traditional product prepared through extremely primitive technology of bhattis and things like that, that product, when they have analyzed, they find that the microparticles are nano size. They are free of mercury or organic molecules, robust structure, no toxicity, and so on and so forth. And that this Ayurvedic synthesis method by that primitive technology is on par with contemporary techniques of nanoparticle synthesis in terms of the output that you get out of that. So it's a very interesting study to show. The metallopharmaceutical is an emerging area. There's very little understood in terms of very few products in the world. We know metals are very, very important in the human biology, but we don't know how to make these products in safe, bioavailable form. And Ayurveda is a master in this field in a branch called Rasa Shastra. And this is one of the products made by Rasa Shastra methods, which BRC has evaluated, and this was inspired by Valliathan's motivation. Management of non-communicable diseases. This is a paper published by University of California, Berkeley, and Ayurvedic people here, and it's published in the Annals of Rheumatology, which is one of the highest impact journals in the field of rheumatology. And this paper is saying that the Ayurvedic logic for management of rheumatoid arthritis gives results which are as good as the best modern drug for rheumatoid arthritis with lesser side effects. So it's a very, it's a path-breaking finding and paper, not an Ayurvedic drug, it's an Ayurvedic therapeutic logic, what they call Chikitsa Sutra. That is what has been tested, and it has been done in a very rigorous manner, otherwise Annals of Rheumatology will not touch, will not publish such a paper. So it is showing the potential that your systems like Ayurveda have for tackling non-communicable diseases. This is an example with rheumatoid arthritis. There is potential for, I was saying that the wellness industry is growing, and today its size is larger than the pharmaceutical industry, the wellness industry, and it is being visualized to grow further and further. Today, the expression of this wellness industry is the institutional form is what they call spas or wellness centers of various kinds, and they are high-end institutions. And I'm not sure, what is the scientific basis of the treatments that they offer. I don't know whether some of you have had the opportunity to visit a wellness center, somewhere in the Himalayas. There is something called Anand Spa. It's an expensive place, not affordable to middle class people, maybe only affordable to upper middle class people, an expensive thing. Now, they offer you, some kind of yoga, massage, good fragrance, good organic food, diet, and so on and so forth. You feel good, you are pampered. And this is what happens in wellness centers world over, this industry that is growing. But India has knowledge which can form the basis for wellness science. And I will just give you a very brief insight into that. There is one word for wellness in Ayurveda, and you have heard the word when I say it to you, swasthya. The grammar or the etymology of the word, what we call nirukti of this word, swasthya, is to be sthit in swa, to be in equilibrium with yourself. This is the meaning of health. If you want to be healthy, you have to be sthit with swa. Okay, that is swasthya. And the shloka on swasthya in Ayurveda goes on to elaborate that swasthya means samadosha, it means equilibrium at the physiological level, samadhatu, equilibrium of body tissues, sama agni, metabolic equilibrium, excretory system, sama malakriya, the excretory system must be in equilibrium. There must be contentment of the indriyas, there must be contentment of the mind. So there are six sort of levels of swasthya. To be swasthya, you must have equilibrium at these six levels. Now, we can develop an entire wellness science based on this. We have clinical parameters and clinical methods to assess someone's wellness if you go to a good place of Ayurveda. And when we work with scientists, we can develop biomarkers for each of these levels. And now when you combine that clinical parameters with biomarkers, you are going to create. And this is the direction. I mean, today in health reform globally, we are saying that all countries are saying that, look, we are spending too much money on disease management. Our entire health sector is designed to address disease management. Why don't we put investment into prevention? Why don't we put investment into wellness? It will make it much more affordable, particularly countries where social security systems in Europe and Scandinavia are very high. The budget on, keeping people managing their diseases is so high, and people live longer and so on and so forth. So they are saying in health sector reform, let's create institutions for wellness and prevention. But they don't know what is the way to do it. Now, India can actually create a program on wellness science out of this integrative approach. If you want to share this science with the world, we'll have to use an integrative approach. It cannot only be on the basis of samadosha, samadhatu, samagni, etc. We'll have to translate them into biological markers. It's doable. It's a 10-year program, but it will result in wellness science. So these are some of the examples I've given you of what is the potential of integrative healthcare in Indian context. We actually have an opportunity for integrative healthcare coming very soon, 2016, this very year. The government of India is reviewing its last health policy, which was 2002. They have put out on public website a draft policy in 2015. It has finished receiving comments. Sometime in 2016, the government is expected to announce a new healthcare policy. And it's time, because the last policy was 2002. This is 2016. India can be the first country to formulate a national integrative healthcare policy and not formulate such a policy out of, some whim or fancy. This is the reality on the ground, which I showed you. Health-seeking behavior. Citizens are demanding, are exercising. Let's say they're not demanding. We don't have demand in that sense. But health-seeking behavior is showing that's how they are behaving. They are exercising pluralistic choices. There are innovations happening. There is huge potential. India can be world leader in integrative healthcare. Complementary medicine movement is rising world over. Not only India, but America has put in money 25 years ago into integrative healthcare through what they call CAM, complementary and alternative medicine, because for them that is alternative, etc. Scandinavian countries have national institutes. So it's happening all over the world because people know that no single system has solutions. So India is in a unique position to, you know, take lead and formulate healthcare policy. We are uniquely located, and because we possess advanced scientific institutions in biomedicine, in life sciences, and we have an incredibly rich traditional knowledge system of our own. Now, this is difficult to see. I'm sorry, I can't enlarge this, but this is just to give you a glimpse of a poster prepared in our university on what we call Systems Ayurveda. This is similar to such posters that are prepared for Systems Biology. It will, if one studies this, you know, it shows the conceptual foundations and logic that informs Ayurveda, and it's very, very sophisticated. There are 300 variables with cause and effect linkages. Many of you, of course, know this word Ayurveda, but you may or may not know what it really means. The translation is very simple. Ayu, life, Veda, knowledge of life. But the actual meaning is, Veda means what they call in Sanskrit, Karya, Karan, Vivechana. It is cause and effect processes around life. That's what Ayurveda means. It is Veda means cause and effect, Karya Karan Vivechana, about life processes. So it's a very sophisticated knowledge system. Now, it's not anything to do just with India. This is a very exciting thing, building integrative platform, because we know that in the method of science, in the outlook of science, in the philosophical framework that informs science, logical positivism, and so on and so forth, we have this limitation that, you know, despite our achievements in understanding life at its fundamental, on its fundamental plane, atoms or molecules or subatomic particles, and now there is a whole lot of deeper understanding of that subject, and of molecular biology, the gap in our understanding of life processes at the systemic level remains, because the method is looking at a reduced, it's a reductionist approach. And so therefore, while we know incredible amount of detail at the part level, we don't have enough understanding of whole. And therefore, when you bridge between systems like Ayurveda, which, you know, we have got very sophisticated theoretical foundations, and science, new perceptions and insights can be revealed. And this is not speculation. New transdisciplinary knowledge is already evolving. I gave you examples of Ayurvedic biology, a few examples. And these are contributing to advancements in basic sciences, pharmacogenomics, clinical medicine, that an Ayurvedic logic. You see, the days of single drug, single target are over. You know, this biology of the human body is too complex to solve it with a single molecule on a single target. I mean, one has got syndromes there. One has, the next breakthrough is not going to be a drug. It is going to be a breakthrough in understanding of biological mechanisms. You have got metabolomics, proteomics, transcriptomics, network pharmacology. That is the framework. And no single molecule, single target is an older story. So we are already seeing contributions in this, in basic sciences, in clinical medicine, in new pharmacology that are emerging. So it's a very important area, integrative healthcare, even for advancement of knowledge. See, one issue that we have in Indian context on integrative healthcare is that it is a traditional science and modern science and tradition and modernity, and there is this confusion. And there is, can we get any inspiration, can we get any new insight by bridging with a traditional knowledge system? I think we need to revise our understanding of modernity and tradition, and need to understand, and you know, this is a 45-minute talk, so as I told you, there's a limit to how much I can get into detail. But just as the present is inevitably derived from the past, so the roots of modernity actually lie in tradition. And it was Europe's colonial arrogance that pushed a monocultural, Eurocentric agenda of science, development, and modernization. And a careful historical analysis may reveal that the correct sociological definition of modernity is in fact evolving tradition. Of course, it is evolving tradition. I mean, certain traditions may have to be discarded if they are no longer of value. So it has to be an evolving tradition you can build upon. You know, the history of modernization in Europe from a sociological, historical perspective could be said to be revitalization of classical Greek tradition. The entire Renaissance came about by a revitalization of classical Greek tradition, and that was the beginning of the entire modern age. So there is this connection, the roots of modernity lie in tradition. This is an understanding that we have lost sight of because of the colonial period, when we were told that if you want to modernize, you have to import everything from us, from outside. And so we forgot that the natural evolution, the evolving tradition, is how any society really modernizes and ought to modernize. And there has been an interruption in our own modernization process due to the colonial and post-colonial pause. And really, modernization, this is an unfinished agenda of modernization. What I'm calling integrative health care is an unfinished agenda of modernization, where we need to really explore the contemporary relevance of our traditional knowledge systems, not really only in healthcare, but in a whole range of fields. In healthcare, several models of integrative healthcare may emerge. Like I told you, the Americans have invested 25 years ago into an office for complementary medicine in the National Institutes of Health, and they made progress over these last 25 years. So you may have many models. You may have a model in which in a certain culture, biomedicine is the pivot. In Chinese, they have already done, China is one country which has done quite a bit of work on integrative healthcare. I don't think you see any functional Chinese clinical establishment which doesn't have follow an integrative approach in China at primary, secondary and tertiary levels. Indian model may have Ayurveda and yoga as its pivot. Uniformity is culturally unviable. I mean, in the integrative healthcare, you may have several models, and that's fine. And I'll end, this is my last slide, that so far as India is concerned, although this 2016 is an opportunity, and I hope that the government takes this opportunity to declare a policy framework which is of integrative health care. This is an immediate opportunity, but it's a very complex exercise, because to implement an integrative health program, it will have to go in stages and steps, and it's a 10-15 year old long program. We will need to look at how to, re-manage or re-administer or change the administration of public health services. Today they work parallelly. There's no convergence at all. We will need to, so that's complex. How do you have different department for Ayush, a different department for modern medicine at central, state, district levels, how do you converge public health services? Co-posting and co-location is a beginning, but it has to be, much more work needs to be done to make it effective. We will need to promote things of like Ayurvedic biology, which is really epistemologically informed research. And we will need to create interface between CSIR, DST, DBT, ICMR, and Ayush. Today we all function parallelly. If we are to promote, Ayurveda biology, we will need, which is even more serious and complex, we will need to do integrative medical education, which is a very complex exercise of how to do it. And as first steps, we can, and there's already being proposed, we can have bridging courses for someone who's done an undergraduate or a postgraduate in medicine in any system. He can take a bridging course, and while he may be MBBS, he can still do a bridging course in Ayurveda or yoga or something, and that would give him some competence to practice that to that extent of his training, and vice versa. So that would be the first step, to do bridging courses for undergraduates, postgraduates, paramedics. And there are already being proposed new streams of integrated medicine, for rural areas and so on and so forth. These are already being proposed. So medical education is an area we have to look at. Regulation is another very important area. We have to look at regulations. Our regulations don't permit effective integrative practice to happen even after training. I mean, if without training there is an issue, you can't have someone untrained to perform something. And there is another huge potential to innovate in the design of the public health system. You know, as I was telling you in my first slide or earlier slides, that we have an institutionally driven public health system, primary, secondary, tertiary. Now, this was not the way healthcare was managed in India, completely institutionally driven. This is a model we borrowed from the British, primary, secondary, tertiary. Now, if you want healthcare, you go to an institution. You have a cough, cold, fever, go to an institution. At primary level, if it's more serious, secondary, tertiary, etc. In India, we have had centuries of experience of a fourth tier in the health system, which is not institutional, which is non-institutional, where the home and the community are the providers of healthcare. And today with ICT, information communication technology tools, it's possible to recreate this fourth tier where you empower millions of households and communities to manage some aspect of common ailments, prevention of wellness. You can see with whatever its strength and weaknesses would have been that this guy, Baba Ramdev, gave a few years of TV and other kinds of large talks, and apparently has a huge following, where he seems to have taught millions of people some various yoga practices, which people claim have helped them. So this is, the delivery is the home. You have given apparently reliable information. So the key thing is, can you revalidate certain practices? We have 6,500 species of plants, and they are located in talukas. So every taluka has its own ecosystem-specific plants. And there's a very interesting Sanskrit shloka. I will recite it for you. Yashmin deshe tu yo jataha, tasmin taj aushadam hitam. And what it means is, nature is so compassionate that it has given every ecosystem the resources needed for the health of that ecosystem. So if I am living in the Himalayas, I don't need to bring plant from the plains. Or if I am in desert, I don't need to bring plant from, every ecosystem has the resources. Neem grows in, the best neem you get in hot, dry, arid habitats. And the reason is that it is useful for the health problems created in that habitat. Ephedrine grows in the Trans-Himalayas, it's a bronchodilator. It doesn't grow in desert, it doesn't grow in rain area. You need bronchodilation there, and nature has provided that particular species growing there. So every ecosystem has resources useful. And if you revalidate their uses and provide that reliable information on an ICT platform, you can revitalize what we call parampara. Parampara is one of a very, very powerful tool of communication. Paramparas have generated and transferred knowledge over generations, you know, in that parampara. Because they get internalized, they get passed on, but there must be reliable knowledge. So you can create this fourth tier. India can be a country which will say, our public health system has four tiers. Three institutional, primary, secondary, tertiary. Fourth, community-based, where the provider is millions of household and community. Fourth tier public health system. You will invest 1 or 2% of your investment in health sector to strengthen this tier. It doesn't, because the providers are all self-provision, you know. So I end my thing here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Darshan Shankar. Now the floor is open for the questions.
Informative lecture. Actually, you are mentioning about the fourth community or the fourth tier. It was already existing in India, what we call grandma's medicine. But the invasion of the colonial powers actually destroyed that particular thing. Now, once again, because of the nuclear families, there are no grandmas in any of the families. So naturally, it has perished actually. Only it was there. Now, once again, we have to regenerate the particular things. That's what I feel.
No, but of course, but that's what I'm trying to say, that, you know, you have 6,500 species of plants and they are ecosystem-based resources. And fortunately, we have documented, you know, traditional pharmacopoeias, what is called in Ayurveda, Dravya Guna Shastra. So we have texts of that where we have actually in our university a database on the properties and application of these plants. So it is possible to revalidate this knowledge using science and a network of institutions who will be engaged in this. And there are institutions like the National Innovation Foundation, you know, which is already sort of looking at some aspects of this. But you can involve a whole lot of institutions in this, revalidate that knowledge, use ICT platform and pass it on to you. When by the time you become grandfather, you know, you will have reliable knowledge, or much before that.
Thank you, sir.
So in the integrated healthcare, as mentioned, you wish medical practitioners to sit together to get an integrated approach for addressing various diseases. But there is so much reluctance by many allopathy practitioners to accept other medicines as pure science. If this is the mindset, how do you wish to go forward?
No, what you say is right. So we'll have to, I mean, while generally what you're saying is right, now you are seeing increasing number of leaders in the medical profession, you know, globally. In India, M.S. Valiathan is a hardcore, you know, surgeon, cardiac surgeon, Padma Bhushan. He has invented devices for cardiology. He has translated Charak, Vagbhat, Shushrut, all the three books. They are published, they are available. So you are having change in mindset happening in a lot of people, you know. So that what you are saying is generally true, and it is true because of prejudice. But prejudices can be overcome for anything, and you have to do it systematically. And it's happening. It's happening.
Yeah, how do we get
I beg your pardon?
Probably allopathy doctors should be made to have an ancillary paper on these other systems of medicine.
No, but this is what I was saying. Medical education is a serious matter, and one can think of bridging courses. Now, people in Europe are doctors, allopathic doctors, are taking bridging courses on Ayurveda and yoga in Germany, in the US. So our people will also do that. Universities in England are offering courses on bridging courses. So this is happening. You know, this complementary movement is happening. It's not got to a size and scale where, you know, we all feel it, but it's there. It's Yeah. These are extraordinary people.
The parampara, what you are referring to, still exists, we know. But we have been seeing that those medicines work slowly compared to others. So there is a tendency for people to go to other medicines than sticking to it and then looking for it.
See, this is a very common misconception in the sense that this idea that slow working has come from management of pain, anesthesia. There is no doubt that, you know, the starting of anesthesia was from a plant source. It is from the cannabis plant. And morphine, which is the molecule that was extracted, and subsequently analogs of it and so on and so forth, have all come from traditional source. But you can give half a kilo of cannabis, it won't give you anesthesia, what a very small amount of morphine will. So the active molecule works very fast. So because of pain management, where acute pain management, not general pain management, now today we in our hospital in the university, we have people coming to us for pain management, not acute, but you know, people suffering from cancer and so on and so forth. But acute pain management or any acute condition, modern chemistry and pharmacology is the answer. You will not get natural sources which can manage those kinds of acute conditions. And that has given the impression that for everything it is faster. But if you have a diarrhea, we will stop it for you faster perhaps than a modern drug with lesser side effects. So it's not that in everything it is slow or anything. It has essentially come out of this.
Actually, he has already asked part of my question, that over the years, the allopathic practitioners, they have been skeptical about Ayurvedic and homeopathy. The thing is that their allegation is that it contains a lot of metals are there, and secondly, that those original herbs or plants which were there in ancient Ayurveda, they are no more present here, so they are using some substituted plants and herbs. I just want your comments on that. And secondly, that what about homeopathy? I just want to know your.
No, so on homeopathy, I don't know enough, except, you know, what I have seen in terms of clinical practice, and you know what I've heard is, and heard from people benefited, is when it benefits tremendously and dramatically. When it doesn't, it doesn't. But homeopathy is not an Indian knowledge system, as you know. I think skepticism is a good thing. It's healthy to be skeptical, you know, you want to know. But it tells us that, you know, there is a need. The only way to overcome skepticism is by giving informed, you know, knowledge. And this is the challenge. This is the only way. And
what is yours? Complementary medicine practices are being produced in USA?
I think they have got work going on all sorts of areas. Mostly it is on non-communicable diseases, in cancers, in the whole range of metabolic disorders. There's lots and lots of projects because their budgets are large. This, what I told you, was supported by the National Institutes of Health, this arthritis study. University of California, Berkeley, and Ayurvedic people here was supported by National Institutes of Health.
What are your expectations prescriptions from the new medical policy which is expected by 2016? Because our country seems to have been divided into two, the rural and the urban. And the good doctors, in spite of all the incentives given by the governments, they are not ready to work in the rural areas. So the rural population has been left to the mercy of the secondary, what you say, secondary means, and the good medical facilities, the good reputed doctors, that they are not available there. So what are your expectations from, because you have got a say in the policy making, I think you seem to be, by your profile, I see that you are a very strong man and can have some influence over that policy. So sir, what are your expectations and what can be done in this regard?
I think the draft 2016 policy is on the net of the, on the website of the ministry, and they have tried to address what you are saying. My own recommendation is that, so that's a serious problem, what you've said. And they are trying to, you know, find ways to deal with that, because that's a serious operational problem. My own advice has been to take the bold step of announcing an integrative and do that integration. It's actually, the word I keep using is integrative. I don't use the word integrated, because it's not a done thing. It's evolving and it'll keep evolving. So integrated is not the word I choose to use, for that reason, that no one knows the answer to, you know. So it will keep on evolving. So integrative is how we leave it open. But that's my expectation.
My question is about the approach you are taking in your university or FRLHT. In the era of super speciality and multiple forms of systems of medicines, how are you? Actually, can you highlight it a little more? Approaching the problem.
I showed you one small slide on that. You see, in the era of super speciality or whatever, this is the era that is being led by life sciences, by physics, chemistry, medical sciences. The limitation in all this is that we have incredible understanding of what is happening at the micro level. We don't know enough of what is happening at the macro level. And so what transdisciplinary seeks to do is that you get a macro level perspective from our knowledge system, and you bridge it with the micro level perspective from there, not only perspective but methods and everything, and that combination extends the frontiers of knowledge. Because the problem with Ayurveda, for example, is that it has a macro view but doesn't know what is happening at the molecular level. There it's the opposite. We know what is happening at that level, we don't know what is happening in the whole biological system. When you combine the two, you can get remarkable things happening. I'll give you an example of a very potential area that I didn't speak about. Progression of disease. In modern medicine, with all the understanding of biology, and we don't know how does a healthy cell become a diseased cell. We know what a diseased cell looks like. We know what a healthy cell is. We have snapshots in between. But we don't know the progression from a disease cell to a healthy cell. We have no theory of disease progression. Ayurveda has a macro view and a theory. It is called Shad Kriya Kal, that a disease progresses through six stages, and each of the stages is described at a macro level. Now, if cell biologists and Ayurvedic people work together, they can begin to look at the behavior of cells in that framework of Shad Kriya Kal. And it's a 10-year work to do serious work. India will win a Nobel Prize for so-called transdisciplinary theory of disease progression. So
Already we have done that with genomics, with pharmacogenomics. We were not able to, we know that modern drugs don't work in the same way on everybody. We have to customize it to your genetic makeup. But we don't know how to classify a population into genotypes. It is Ayurveda's phenotypic framework that has opened that whole door, and 10 years of time has been saved. The Chinese have also picked it up, and now it's a going thing.
So you need to say that at least here you are conceptually, Ayurveda got or Indian systems have got a better stance for going for the integrated approach, integrative or
yeah, India products. Has a terrific opportunity because we know we have a competence in science and we have a competence in Ayurveda. You can't call either of them superior or inferior or anything. They have got different perspective. Panchmahabhut Siddhant is a macro perspective on nature. The atomic theory or the cellular theory is a micro perspective. There's difference in perspective. You can look at a thing like that, or you can look at a thing. The perspective is very but the whole knowledge is constructed on the micro perspective. Here, I'm using very lay language. Here, the entire knowledge is constructed on a macro perspective. The combining of which is superior, inferior, there is not the question. It is just a different perspective. It gives rise to a different knowledge, a different way of understanding. Both ways are useful. Both have limitations. Both have strengths. When you combine the two, you can get something very interesting.
The fundamental question is how we can combine, because these two are diametrically opposite.
You see, the whole, they're not diametrically opposite. The whole, I'll put it in very simple language and you answer me yourself. Is there a relationship between the whole and the part?
Definitely.
That's it.
Yes.
But that relationship is not one to one. The whole is not equal to the part. Not even the sum of parts is equal to the whole, yet they are related. If you explore that relationship, that is the path roadmap for transdisciplinary research in the context I'm talking about.
So in this context, I want to say something. You talked about primary care, secondary care, and tertiary care. Of course, Ayurvedic medicine, they can work in primary domain.
And secondary.
To some secondary. So that means that combining Ayurvedic knowledge as well as allopathic knowledge requires that we, I don't see that how this thing can be combined together. I just want your comments on that.
No, you can combine. I mean, you have now even a tertiary healthcare center in Delhi, and some of you are from Delhi, there's Medanta. It's a tertiary healthcare center. Medanta has, in its vision and in its operation, now taken on Ayurveda and yoga people, and they are dealing with, they are addressing many problems using that where they have gaps, and it works well, and they are publishing on it. So it can work in all those contexts, in primary, in secondary, in tertiary.
Yeah, post-operative kind of...
Post-operative, but even in complex conditions, it can work at all levels. At non-healing ulcer, we've had cases of, let's say, someone who has got, in our own hospital, someone who the modern hospital said you have to get your leg amputated because it is turning towards gangrene. By their limits, they said if you don't do it immediately, you are going to be in difficulty because of gangrene setting in. Naturally, no one wants that leg amputated. They come to an Ayurvedic place, can you help? In this case, or in many cases of this kind, we have been able to help, and no need for amputation. But not to say that Ayurveda can cure all conditions of gangrene. Our own doctor, relative of the doctor, got gangrene setting in, but the limit got crossed, and the person died of that. So there's a limit, but our limit is different from their limit. When they said it has to be cut, we could stop it. But beyond a point, neither can do anything. So this is not a primary health care. This is at least secondary health care. So there are situations in all the three where there will be scope.
Only thing is, when you sit together, you should have open mind to listen to others.
Absolutely, absolutely. This is not, cannot be done without that, which is the difficulty, as you yourself pointed out.
Sir, as you said, there are 3,500 species for the...
6,500.
But I heard or I know that there are some herbs for the health by the creation of God. But as you said, there are 6,500, but why they are not brought out like that in the practical this one's use?
To those who have access to it and believe in the traditional science, that access is available. But I'll give you an example. So you have all heard of this plant called Brahmi. You know, Brahmi Amla Tel, here someone is selling it, Dabur and all that. Brahmi plant, easy to grow, it must be in this campus also. 1500 BC, the Dravya Guna Shastra reports on Brahmi, Smriti Prada, that means enhances memory. It is actually very useful maybe in Alzheimer's, dementia, any neurodegenerative disorder where memory is involved, Brahmi is useful. But people like you and me who are educated in the way we are, we said, who knows whether it is Smriti Prada or no? Is it really memory enhancing? A few years ago, Shono Chatterjee in NCBS, just for fun, he said, let me see whether this Brahmi is Smriti Prada. And he did an animal experiment, and to his surprise, he found in the hippocampus region of the brain, within a few weeks of giving that Brahmi, there were changes at the molecular level, there were synapses that were, you know. So he said, there's absolutely no doubt that this is enhancing memory. So as this sort of information begins to, I have told you today that storing water in copper is good. If I don't give you that modern data on E. coli, Salmonella, Vibrio cholera, Giardia, you won't do it. After hearing that data, examining it, checking it, a lot of people may start doing it. So today we have to revalidate traditional knowledge in terms of science. And that is the exercise that is involved, part of the exercise involved in the integrative healthcare movement. That is part of the exercise involved. So we'll have to do things like that to make confidence come again. Or you have to understand the logic of Ayurveda, which you know, you have not studied for throughout your education.
That it's a reality, 6,500, because so much that species available means I don't think other medicine required. When so much species available, why not we stick on to that than going to other medicines?
Like I told you,
there is some herbs are there in our practical life. We are used in so many forms. But
So for prevention, for chronic conditions.
To different states or country, I don't think that 6,500 species are available for the sake of health.
You mean the information is not available? Are you asking that? Are you saying information is not available, or what are you saying?
First time hearing this 6,500 species for the health.
You are welcome to come and visit the institute. I have a database.
I'll just add.
Every single species is named, every single species is referenced. You can see the information on the species, etc. Of course, out of the 6,500 recorded and documented in Ayurveda, Unani, Siddha, Swarikpa, is only around 2,500. The remaining are plants which communities have reported for certain things. which have not been studied by our systems. Like, you know, we have two streams of knowledge, community knowledge and codified knowledge. Codified systems have only studied 2,500, but that data is available.
There, but as a herb for the health's sake, but I have my own doubt that so many numbers are there or not.
I think it's good to have doubt, but the only way to clarify your doubt is to look into it more deeply.
I'll add to your clarification. In fact, Dr. Shankar has initiated the traditional knowledge digital library. There are thousands of formulations which have been recorded from traditional knowledge, folk wisdom, and many other systems of medicines across the country. Thousands of formulations, not just 6,500 species. There are combinations of these species which are being used, combination of parts, different parts which are being used for treating different ailments.
Yeah, the TKDL information.
TKDL is a vast information.
TKDL as of today is 200,000 herbal formulations computerized by CSIR. But that was done for preventing frivolous patents. So we have given it to patent examiners all over the world, those 200,000 formulations with their indications of use as a prior art, you know, to prevent, to show that we knew. That's right. The figure is 200,000.
There's an app for around 50 formulations. You can just Google it out and you can see the 50 formulations which are available for public.
In the demo.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sir, now, world over, whole society is highly scared of these three diseases or ailments. One is that of cancer, and then next diabetes and heart ailments. And where do we stand now with integrated approach and with different approaches between the two?
I don't know the answer to that. All I can say is that we should really do more. Already something is being done in terms of integrative approaches, but you may get some better picture, you know, if we keep on pursuing these integrative approaches. For all these three conditions that you mentioned, there is work going on, and so there are bits and pieces, you know. I mean, today if Himalaya Drug Company has reached a turnover of, it started with 20-30 crore turnover, today it has reached 1500 crore turnover. You and me are buying their medicines, you know, and medicines are for many conditions. Of course, so there is work going on cancer, there is work going on diabetes. Integrative approach may provide some solutions, but a lot of work still needs to keep going on. There is good potential in following that approach.
But at the same time, people, they are experiencing, but they are unable to express about the domination of the Western interest of pharma industry on the whole process of health planning and approach to cures and all. Again, how to get clear messages? Doubtful arena.
That's a difficult question. I'm not sure I have the answer to that. That's a very strong. The pharmaceutical lobby is a very strong thing worldwide, and they distort a lot of medicine, not only in terms of drugs, even in terms of diagnostics, in so many areas.
Well, as there is no more questions, I have a small query to ask. I quite liked when you said that modernity is nothing but a continuance or a evolving tradition. So do you think the approach to integrated healthcare can be the one which we saw a lot of
the publications, they're coming in Springer and Elsevier and those kind of publications. So it is time to validate some of the traditional approaches through these scientific methods, and also have the courage and the audacity to reject some of them if they don't conform to the present conditions, and then move ahead with those which sort of...
No, absolutely. Absolutely you have to do that, but I had used a phrase that you have to do this in an epistemologically informed manner, because in answer to the question from that gentleman, these are two different knowledge systems which don't have one-to-one relationship in terms of concepts, categories, and so on and so forth. So once you establish the relationship between part and whole and make the right framework for doing your research, absolutely you should do that rigorously and throw it out if it doesn't make any sense.
And my query was, how long we have been doing this, like how long we have been sort of following this scientific approach to get it published in the international peer-reviewed journal. And if we are doing this consistently, instead of, for instance, having a specialized journal for Ayurveda, rather than mainstreaming it to the present mainstream of medicine, and how far you have been successful in that?
You see, now you must realize, you all are all from scientific institutions. So you would know what are the investments that go into a DST, DBT, CSIR kind of program. You will be shocked to hear that I had this conversation with the secretary of the Department of Ayush maybe 1 month ago. And I had the information, so that's how I asked him. I asked him, I said, sir, are you aware in the year 2015-16, which is just getting over now in March, what is the expenditure that the Department of Ayush spent on what they call extramural research, which is research for supporting institutions? And the figure was 6 crores for India. 6 crores for the whole of India. This is 2015-16. When I used to come to this institute, I've been coming here for the last 20 years. Dr. Rajaramanna, you would ask me, Darshan, when are we going to translate shlokas into science? He would ask me this question. And I would say, sir, people like you have to influence policy. Look, you have put it on a 6 crore in 2015-16. What were you doing in 47 onwards? You were spending nothing. So when you don't invest in systematic, now Ayurveda biology, which is a DST program, spends more than what Ayush spends. They have spent, but not a large amount of money. Over the last 7-8 years, they have spent about 50-60 crores over 7-8 years. But with that kind of sub critical investment, what do you expect?
Okay, I would like to request Dr. G. Appa Rao to deliver the vote of thanks.
Very good evening to all of you. I am one among the court's participants. I feel I am honored to propose vote of thanks on the just now concluded talk, Integrative Health Care Emerging Paradigm in 21st Century, delivered by Professor Darshan Shankar sir. Sir, in your talk, you have covered various areas which are very much important to human beings, particularly the health. Then Sar has covered in his talk the Indian scenario, not only that, in the international. Then he has correlated Indian healthcare scenario, ground reality, which is interlinked are governed by the drinking water and the food and hygiene and nutrition and so on. Then also he has covered innovations in this area, healthcare area, what are the innovations are going on and the policy. He also very clearly and nicely narrated the significance of a common metal, that is copper, which is used for the purification of water. And olden days in our house, we used to have this kind of utensils or water, maybe food or storing containers. But with the revolution of materials and material science, like stainless steel, when it has come, we are hardly finding the things made of such useful metals and alloys. It's very interesting. And the significance of Ayurveda, yoga, biomedicine, and so on. With all his vast experience in the concerned field, he has educated us, enlightened us. I immensely thank, on my personal behalf, on behalf of everyone present here. Thank you so much. I request all of you join with me to give a big applause for his wonderful talk. Thank you so much.